Fun.
Hello, everyone. Sziasztok. Dzień dobry. I was thinking maybe we wait just 1 minute and I will start the introduction, if that's all right with everyone. But first of all, thank you for all those who are joining on time. Okay, so just that we don't lose time, I will start with the introduction. Welcome everyone again. My name is Gabor Ehrlich, and I'm very excited to welcome you all at the fourth act of FEINART Public Lecture Series, which will be presented by the interdependent curator, Kuba Szreder from Warsaw. For those of you joining us or this series for the first time, just a very brief introduction. I'll just say that FEINART is an innovative training network that is supported by the Marie Curie Actions of Horizon 2020, which is a flagship initiative of the European Union. FEINART is an international network of 4 universities, 7 partner institutions from the field of art, and 11 early stage researchers that is set out to investigate the future of European independent art spaces in the period of socially engaged art. The aim of the lecture series is to invite renowned theorists and practitioners to share their experience, thoughts, and concerns in regards to the future prospects and challenges of this wild realm we call socially engaged art. On the one hand, this lecture series is tailored to the training program itself so that the shared knowledge can find its way to channel back into the researchers. And on the other, it serves as a public outreach platform targeting professionals and enthusiasts and inviting all participants to engage and interact with the acclaimed players of the field. Therefore, it is important that I mark it here that this event is being recorded and will be published on our site, that is feinart.org, as well as on our YouTube channel. So please, if I can ask you to keep your mic muted for the time you're not speaking. Thank you. And before I introduce today's speaker, it always starts like that, before I introduce the speaker, but really, I have the pleasure to announce that the next FEINART public lecture will take place on the 3rd of June, and will be delivered by Maria Hlavajova from BAK, that is Basis for Aktuelle Kunst Utrecht. And the title of Maria's lecture is From Art Institution to Community Portal. And she will present this lecture after a brief introduction by our next host, my esteemed colleague, Sophie Mack-Schramm. Again, that is the 3rd of June, so save the date, and we very much hope to see you there. For the real Zoom savvies out here, I would also like to invite you to a panel discussion called British Art Show 9 and Socially Engaged Art, which is on the 21st of May, starting at 4 p.m. British summer time, where part of the FEINART team, which is based in the University of Wolverhampton, that is John Roberts, Maria Mrktisheva, Vai Vai Chan, and I will be talking with Hamad Nassar, who is the co-curator of the British Art Show 9. And we will like to focus this conversation on the social engagement or the social engaged practices included in the art show from the perspective of the curator. And now, okay, I'm thrilled to introduce you tonight's speaker, Kuba Szreder. Kuba is a lecturer at the Department of Art Theory at the Academy of Fine Arts in Warsaw, He's a graduate of sociology from the Jagiellonian University, Krakow, and he received his PhD from the Loughborough University School of the Arts. Kuba combines practice-based research with curating interdisciplinary projects and political engagement. He has worked with many artistic institutions and collectives all over Europe. In 2009, he co-initiated Free Slow University of Warsaw, with which he completed several inquiries into the political economy of contemporary artistic production, such as Joy Forever, Political Economy of Social Creativity. That was 2011, and Art Factory, Division of Labor and Distribution of Resources in the Field of Contemporary Art in Poland, which was in 2014. In 2010, he started to cooperate with Critical Practice, a London-based research cluster, with which he concluded several research projects about the modes of being in public and the social process of evaluation. Since 2012, he has worked with the Citizens Forum for Contemporary Art in Poland, with which he has campaigned for the betterment of the conditions of work in the sector of contemporary art. In 2018, together with Katrin Böhm, he co-initiated the Center for Plausible Economies, a research cluster devoted to reimagining economy by using artistic means. In 2020, he co-established the Office for Post-Artistic Services, the aim of which is to employ artistic competences in support of progressive social movements. Kuba Szreder is the author and editor of several catalogs, books, readers, book chapters, essays, and articles, all devoted to social, economic, and theoretical aspects of the contemporary art. His current research interests include interdependent curating, new models of artistic institutions, post-artistic theory and practice. His new book, The ABC of the Projectariat, will be published by Manchester University Press in 2021. And really just the last thing, please do ask questions from Kuba, and you can do it in two ways. One is that you type it in the chat and we will raise all those questions at the end of his talk. And you can also just react and raise your hand at the end of the presentation you will be seeing right now. And finally, I'm delighted to give the stage, or maybe it's better to say to give the diving board to Kuba Szreder.
Oh yeah, for the dive beneath the tip of artistic iceberg. Thanks Gabo for introduction. Thank you. Karen, do you want to say something? Or is it like, is this hand, does it mean that?
I'm clapping.
Clapping, okay. Gabo, claps for you. Thank you very much for excellent introduction. And thank you very much for having me here. And I'm really glad to be part of this, of FEINART as a research platform. And I'm glad that we managed to establish this thought sustaining environment in times when it seems that we actually are in a dire need of this type of international platforms of exchange. So what's going to happen? I'm going to share some slides with you. Here it goes. I'm going to have a, just give me a second. Okay, good. There is quite a lot of visual tips here included in this presentation. But I'll not explain every image that I'm presenting. There will be, I think, 44 of them. So it's quite a lot of visual material. And if anyone wants to chat about something, or because I will refer to a project or a practice that will possibly require a presentation of its own, while I'll simply sleep through on my dive beneath the tip of the artistic iceberg. So we can, but hoping that there will be the time enough to talk about it later on. You all know how it actually goes. So now I'm seeing only my own slide presentation. So this is slightly weird as I'm talking to my own slides, but well, here it goes, the blessings and vices of e-communication. Anyway, let me start. So the title of today's lecture is Towards Interdependent Curating, Beneath the Tip of the Artistic Iceberg. So I want to tackle actually these two things, like both interdependent curating, but I will rather enhance it than dwell in depth into it, and and elaborate more on the notion of artistic iceberg and what happens on its tip and what happens beneath it. But like the general question that I'm asking myself kind of like not only today, but in general is what would the interdependent curating entail in the artistic networks that trade on promises of independence just to exploit individualistic aspirations of precarious art workers, and how to facilitate the shift from independence to interdependence. These are like the basic premises of this presentation. But as I told you, actually, I will dwell more in this kind of iceberg and economies of contemporary art that are based visually on the visual essay Iceberg and Economies of Contemporary Art that was published last year and that was made together with Katrin Böhm. And the images that you see here are of her own making. So it's very important to acknowledge her contribution. But basically, I try to tackle this question about interdependence in an upcoming book that Gabor was so kind to mention, The ABC of the Projectariat, where I discuss political economy of artistic circulation. And basically, Projectariat is a group of people who live and work in the project, do not own much, but their own capacity to circulate. But today I will approach this problem of interdependence and independence from a slightly different angle of the Icebergian economies of contemporary art. This kind of pata science owes much to the collective inquiries of the Center for Plausible Economies and the alliance with the Community Economies Research Network. So maybe this is a good moment to chat a bit about this image that you see here, and also to tell you a bit about CPE. CPE, the Center for Plausible Economies, is a mock institution or mock department of the feminist economic feminist enterprise from London called Company Drinks. And what you see here is one of the workshops that we did in 2018 together with CERN, which is Community Economies Research Network, that is co-established by Katrin Gibson, that you also see here on the picture, and basically is a research network, international research network of feminist economists. And out of this alliance, the concept of the interdependence evolved. Currently under development as a global network of interdependent enterprises and collectives. And my understanding of interdependent curating is indebted to following definition. The interdependence is, and here let me quote actually from Katrin McKinnon, who wrote this definition after our meeting in Rovereto in June 2009, organized by another mock institution called La Foresta and Comunitas Frizzante. The interdependence is envisioned as a way to bring to the surface the ubiquity of community economy activities by inviting organizations to add a mock business identity to their organization's name, to use IDT for interdependent instead of LTD or INC, means limited or incorporated. The IDT would signal membership of the interdependence, an identifier that could connect and make visible the scale of community economy initiatives. The interdependence is a response to the naysayers who respond to our examples of community economy, economy practices and initiatives by saying, that's nice, but is it scalable? In response, we can say ubiquity is our scale. And this notion of interdependence deeply embedded in feminist economies and the kind of conception of which trades on cooperative community practices that happen below the surface of economic iceberg is something that inspires my thinking about how we could envision different forms of curatorial and artistic practice in the expanding field of art. But also to analyze the composition of artistic universe, I use a scheme of the iceberg developed by mainly also including others, J.K. Gibson Graham. I use this scheme of the economic iceberg to deconstruct the artistic economies just as they deconstructed capitalocentric visions of economy. So basically the argument of feminist economies, and this is actually a quite contentious issue, but I think it's a quite interesting take on the economic universe, is to say that the realm of paid wage labor, production for markets and capitalist businesses is only tip of the economic iceberg. So what happens beneath the surface are all these informal transactions, also forms of labor that are not necessarily of the financialized nature, and yet they underpin the economy proper. So all the realm that is actually economically visible because it is accounted for, it is monetized, it is financialized, is, as feminist economists argue, a tip of the iceberg. The basis of which is composed is vaster and without which it would have been impossible to imagine economy as it is run today. And this diagram is clearly embedded in the feminist critique of what J.K. Gibson Graham called capitalocentric notions of economy. But I think more importantly, it is devised in order to explain the exploitation of invisible maintenance work, but more generally to the extraction of extraction of surplus value by the exploitation of unpaid or underpaid work of humans and non-humans alike. Because here it's also this ecological strand of this thinking is very important. What is also equally important is very rarely this type of exploitation is framed as contractual waged labor. And I think that the consequences of this kind of thinking are pretty significant when it comes to understanding the economy and also to understand the forms of resistance that could be imagined in response to these forms of exploitation. But that's also a topic for yet another lecture, but I will gladly come back to it if there is such a will afterwards. It's more like I propose it here as one of the points of reference or kind of inspiration. But what is also important, and here we come back to this icebergian economies of contemporary art, is that making anything invisible or something invisible means not accounted for, facilitates exploitation of this something as a mere externality of economic equation. So like in classical, or like classical, let's say, feminist Marxist analysis of the 70s onwards, thus was interpreted the invisible, economically invisible labor of women who worked in homes or in households in order to reproduce life as such, or like also workforce, but the labor was never directly paid for. So for example, like campaigns such as Wages for Housework were tackling or like targeting precisely this kind of like dispersed form of exploitation, in which something is indispensable and yet it is unpaid. And it can be exploited precisely because it is unpaid and precisely because it is economically invisible. And I find this particular aspect of the of this feminist deconstruction of the capitalocentric, or basically of the capitalist economy, to be of inspiration to understand what is happening in the field, or like in this expanding field of art. Because the invisibility of dispersed work of artistic multitudes and creative ecosystems at large enables their exploitation. This is one of the premises of the dark matter theory, but to which I will come back. I saw Greg here. Hello, Greg, and Greg Cholette. And but then we will come back. I will come back to this later on, because it's actually the question whether it is in fact, or how can we trace these types of exploitation of underpaid or unpaid or invisible labor of artistic multitudes, and how do they underpin the functioning of artistic universe at large? I think that it is a case, but it's also cannot be misunderstood in a very, let's say, narrow application of analyzing, for example, the speculation with art, or like art market, or speculation with prices of artistic objects. It's much vaster than that. We are talking here about values rather than prices. In any case, it is important to address this exploitative relation between top of artistic iceberg and the realms located beneath it. In the same time, one should deconstruct hegemony instead of reinforcing it, and consider the relative character of the notions that trickle down from the top of artistic iceberg. Here, to come back to this notion of capitalocentric economy and to this relation between invisibility and visibility, maybe I will just come back to this, right? So making these things beneath the surface of economic visibility invisible is a mean of sustaining capitalist hegemony. So it's a mean of exploitation. By saying that this kind of like child labor, or like unpaid labor of love or care is not an economic activity, is a way of exploiting this type of labor and reinforcing the means, the modes of capitalist economy. And I think that pretty similar processes unfold in this expanding field of art. And that's why I wrote in the beginning of this, like as an introduction or the blurb of this talk, that the critique of political of economy of art is intimately related to the revision of its social ontology. Or in less academic terms, what art is depends on how, where, and by whom it is made, owned, distributed, and used. And far too often, we accept the concepts developed on the top of artistic iceberg as if they were universally viable. And maybe I'll just start from the tip of the iceberg, and then I will, as Gabor said, dive beneath it. Well, and I will just like, you know, this is, I think, quite well known, and especially amongst the people who gathered here, this type of critique is nothing new, and I will not quote here directly people, because it's something that it also could be expanded into a more, into a kind of like more detailed analysis, let's say. But anyway, so I trade here more with a kind of general slogans, but we could talk about this at length or in detail later on, how this kind of gallery exhibition nexus is composed. Anyway, let's say that it is the art world of 1% closely aligned with the global financial oligarchies. It is a merry-go-round of duty-free art with huge global turnover of objects, bodies, and different forms of capital, money, reputation, connections. I think also it's very important to say that it has expanded exponentially over the last, let's say, 4 to 5 decades. So now it is a pretty vast social world, which is actually also, I wouldn't call it one art world, in fact, but still it is more of a nexus that links together quite a lot of different agents, institutions, biennials, fairs, individuals all over the world. In this nexus, art objects are peddled, speculated with, exhibited, and stored. As you possibly know, most of art bought and sold is not necessarily living or like it's never exhibited. In fact, it's mainly stays in different art storages that are also located in various free ports all over the world. This art world says, yes, it is upbeat and affirmative. It embraces its own integration with the secrets of global exploitation. Its dwellers like to make art for the affluent people. And the last, this last sentence is in fact a direct quote. Not even a direct quote, it's more of a paraphrase of an email sent by one of the global artists, globally recognized artists, who rejected the invitation by CATPC, a Congolese Art League of Former Plantation Workers, to partake in its program of White Cube that it was established in a former Unilever plantation in Congo, in Lusanga. So this was, you know, he rejected because he likes to make art for the affluent people. In this art world, the romantic stereotype of studio practice underpin a mass fabrication of individually attributable objects. And I think it is quite interesting that, you know, like very often we are thinking about, or like what is being said about this kind of circulation or the nexus is the loss of autonomy. I'm not sure whether we are actually talking about that. I think that the autonomy as such is rather kind of like becomes part of the new social assemblage, like certain romantic notions or like notions that we know from the discussions about autonomous art are being reinterpreted and practiced differently, and yet they are kept as such. So for example, like Jeff Koons can say, yes, this is all my work. I mean, like, you know, like there were documentaries in which he says precisely this kind of things, right? Like talking about his studio assistants as if they were their hands. I think it's an interesting point or like line of reflection that this kind of ideals of the autonomous artistic practice are being reinserted into something that is that operates according to a different rule set. And anyway, like, you know, talking about this, it's like this like weird romantic faith in painting horses or like studio practice as an epitome of human agency seems to be a rather weird theoretical projection. But this is a different discussion. I just wanted to say it here as a side note. And the rules of this art world are currently defined by the gallery exhibition Nexus, that trades just as much as on post-conceptual pranks. I think it is still using this kind of like Dante's, or like it's still seeped in or like embedded or infused with this Dante's, Arthur Dante's understanding of the art world as an atmosphere of artistic theory and the knowledge of the history of art. So basically anything can become art, it is utterly deskilled. And yet it trades on another invention of Marcel Duchamp, maybe even more significant, namely on the certification of multiples as original copies of authorially attributable ideas. It is a late invention of Duchamp and Arthur Schwartz. 12 copies of The Fountain, as you possibly know, were produced between 1950 and 1933. And this kind of invention of mass fabrication, or like basically mass or like limited fabrication and yet more than one original fabrication of artistic objects is and still defines economic underpinnings of this circulation of all of the gallery exhibition nexus. And I think that this artificial scarcity and speculative economy of singularities helps us to tackle such recent phenomena as NFT mania. And it is also it is like what you see here, it's a non-original copy of the copyable conglomerate or assemblage of the GIFs. It's called First 5000 Days by Beeple, and one of the NFT artists that was sold in 2000. It's significant because it was sold for $69 million US dollars as NFT auction organized, I think this year, by Christie's. I think it was this year. So this is also an interesting example of how this kind of like artificial scarcity was finally adopted by the digital art scene, but started more with hacktivist type of dissolution of authorship, and finally became economically prominent and actually also artistically, it's paradoxically also artistically more acceptable by at least mainstream media, when it finally managed to find ways how to create these non-fungible tokens as certificates of originality of given whatever this means in this particular context of this kind of images or digital artworks. Anyway, like I wanted to come back maybe here also, like Gabo mentioned this art activism and Freestyle University that I was involved in. So of course this Playground for the Rich is also a distributed art factory, and which is manned by this precarious projectariat. And most of the projectarians are actually rather poor, but also projectarians, also artists and other people who not necessarily work on projects. There may be a lot of temping people, but there also may be a lot of studio artists, but most of them are anyway rather poor, especially if accounted for by the standards of global metropolis where they congregate and try to make their living, or where we congregate and try to make our living. It's a very complex class composition of poverty jet setters. This precarity is matched and mixed with relative privilege and aspiration with relative deprivation. What you see here, possibly most of you recognize, is a queue during the possibly one of the first days of the biennial. We all know the picture, or like at least quite a few of us knows. But this this relativity of this deprivation or precarity has to be now, I think, it's pretty important to account for it, because especially it's quite striking, the relativity of like this precarious, of how precarious this labor really is, even viewed in the global perspective, considering the yawning gap between global north and south. But this is not necessarily only an argument about artists or art workers or artistic projectariat. It is basically the argument about people like everybody who is not utterly poor in the global north is definitely much more rich than most of the people living in the global south. So this is a slightly different discussion, or definitely not only a discussion about the condition of artistic labor. So now maybe let's think about this, what happens beneath the tip of the artistic iceberg. And this is typically analyzed through the lenses of the artistic dark matter theory that was devised by Greg Cholet. And I think that this is one of the most inspiring theoretical concepts devised in the last, let's say, 10 years. I feel it's slightly awkward now explaining it to you as as a person who actually devised it is here with us. But let me try anyway. It's always also weird to hear your own theories misinterpreted by others. So Greg, please bear with me. But then here, dark matter is basically a concept from taken from, or a metaphor taken from astrophysics, where it denotes this, it's like actually a astrophysical hypothesis coined in order to explain the gravitational pulls in the universe that expands much less than it would result from the equations that take into consideration only this matter that shines, means which reflects light. So in the physical universe, obviously the kind of like 60 or 70% of the universe mass is invisible, and yet it maintains the gravitational forces that pull the universe together. So the same goes, or like this metaphor is applied to artistic universe in order to explain how it maintains its own social gravity or its own gravitational pull, saying that there is a lot of this hidden mass of people who are not never on the top and yet who are actually invisible, not recognized as or unrecognized. And yet their daily labors, their also aspiration, communicational capacities are necessary, purchase power as well. They flock to art events or to attend art courses are necessary in order for artistic universe to reproduce itself. And I think that this dark matter theory is fits pretty nicely is quite theoretically elegant, especially if we consider it in the year of this artistic iceberg. I think it's a pretty similar type of argument that we have a labor of social reproduction or basically also quite informal pretty often that is unrecognized and despite of this lack of recognition plays an extremely important role in maintaining the social reproduction of the universe at stake in this particular case of the social world or like of the social composition of the art world or art worlds, in fact, as I would argue. And yet I believe it needs a minor corrective and we have been discussing about it quite a lot. It's not never one art world. I think there are many different art worlds that has to be taken into consideration in the era of expanding field of art and proliferating art worlds. Means global dispersion of artistic idioms and social worlds that sustain them. What's happening in such semi-peripheric places like Warsaw or Budapest differs from what is happening in New York Center art world and should not be understood using theories that are coined to cope with its devolution. Moreover, what is happening in London or New York is much bigger than what's happening on the tip of artistic iceberg. Why I say it? I mean, I think that like one of the motivations for formulating this corrective is also my daily experience as a teacher, as an organizer, also as a curator, independent or whatever. Because it very often happens that, for example, on the courses of art theory, we take texts of, let's say, Andrea Fraser. And then, which I think is one of the artists and theoreticians who best explained how this art world of 1% operates. And then we take these texts which are based on the notions of this ever-expanding universe that is able to also cannibalize its own critique, that integrates everything into its own institutional framework, and that is also, reproduces itself by this kind of like expansion and extension of its own rather crooked economic and ontological models. It means it turns everything into art, and what art is actually understood precisely in such terms, right? This is art. And everything can become such art, this is undeniable, and yet the vast majority of things doesn't. So like when I think about what is happening in such kind of like weird social, post-socialist, slightly authoritarian continental European countries such as Poland, it is very hard to understand, for example, how the artistic institutions are run if we think about them as if they were Guggenheims or MoMAs. They are not and won't be. Even if, and this is a very important step, this kind of theories are often imported in order to explain or in order to kind of frame the aspiration also of the local agents. So there is often a discussion, for example, about activist art or like different arts that happen outside of this gallery exhibition nexus as if they were all just a resource to be used in this ever-expanding artistic universe, which is then understood as if it was precisely the same art world as it functions in New York top tier of speculative art market. And it very, very, very rarely is. So for example, in artistic institutions in Poland, these are not ultra rich people who man the boards of artistic institutions. The boards are actually barely existent, and the role is very small, but these are rather art experts or professors or people who are experts in the field. The problem that these institutions face is of a different nature. It's a direct dependency on the state power and on the kind of like lack of autonomy thereof, or like related to this rather precarious position that these institutions have. And I'm sure that Gabo or other people from Hungary know perfectly well what I mean by saying that, because the art field was obliterated or at least ravaged by authoritarian cultural practices. And yet beneath the tip of artistic iceberg, especially if we consider this global perspective, art can be many things, and it is sustained by the multitude of plausible art worlds. And how these art worlds are conceived is also a matter for maybe another the discussion. I will not dwell too much on that because it trades on another sociological concept of Howard Becker, who wrote famously, I think, in 83 or 84, the book called Art Worlds, always in plural. And this concept was taken by the collective Basecamp, who together with Stephen Wright published an atlas of this kind of like what they called plausible art worlds, I think back in 2011 or 12. Maybe more about this kind of different arts that are here, that we are talking about here. For example, art can be a wind turbine that repurposes the artistic conventions in order to make better or at least much more interesting art. Saying art here is already a bit problematic, because we have, like, when we say art, we have the usually it's an easel painting, at least in the kind of like in the common sensical view. It's typically related to actually pretty traditional notions of what art is. Sometimes it may be a fountain or a urinal. It might be a Beeple's digital patchwork, or it might be abstract expressionism, and or it might be this kind of action. The status of which is in fact rather hybrid. And yet, I think, makes sense to use a notion of art to describe it as well. Basically, what is happening on this image, it is an action by the group Liberate Tate called The Gift that happened in 2014, using the conventions regulating building of public collections in Britain, because this action happened in Tate Modern, as a group of ecologically minded activists that agitated for severing the ties between Tate Group and British Petroleum, brought this wind turbine as a gift to the collection of Tate. It was one of the series of actions using obviously the conventions that we discussed, that I discussed before, such as ready-mades, the conventions also regulating how the collections are built, because there is a ruling saying that every gift has to be considered by the collections committee. Here, interestingly, the wind turbine was not accepted as a gift, but the documentation of this action was. So now it sits in the repository of Tate. And also, obviously, it was part of the activist campaign. As Liberate Tate, I think, organized between 2009 and 2016, several of such actions, agitating, as I said, for the dissolution of this connection between large extractivist corporation, British Petroleum, and the Tate Group, asking for seizing of this kind of like what they called art washing of tarnished extractivist reputations. And they sort of succeeded because in, I think, 2016, this sponsorship deal was relegated by the decision of BP and Tate. But interestingly, this this kind of artistic art activist action was part of the long strategically planned activist campaign and directly sitting within it. And because of this, I think it was a better art and not the worst art, or like the, it was actually a much more interesting art, precisely because it had this kind of like activist veneer, or not even veneer, activist trust. I think it is more more likely or more appropriately to say it in this way. Because otherwise, just let's imagine that this was a kind of typical commission of like Unilever series. I don't think that it would be actually interesting. It would be pretty shallow if any artist invited by Tate would have brought their wind turbine. I think we would think that this is like a really bad art. So here we have actually something much more interesting because it happened outside of this type of apparatuses that regulate how the commissions are being distributed and exhibitions are being made or collections are being created. Or this kind of art, it can be a company drinks, an enterprise, a feminist art enterprise from London. That I mentioned it because it is a home base of Center for Plausible Economies. And company drinks is an artistic enterprise that specializes in producing soda waters. And here what you see, it is a post-Brexit drink series called Sour Soda, a very soury drink. You see all the people who actually drank it and the faces. I think that's how people felt in London after Brexit, that most, quite a few of them feels like that now as well. I could also make, or Katrin actually much better, would make an excellent presentation about how company drinks is structured. I will also not dwell on it, but if anybody would like to hear more, I'll gladly discuss this example during our discussion. Or this kind of art that is maintained in the plausible art worlds, it can be a demonstration of paintings. Here it's an example. This particular demonstration of paintings was organized by the Consortium for Post-Artistic Practices as part of the post-artistic bloc on the anti-fascist demonstration in March 2009. And this particular demonstration of paintings actualized Henrik Streng's painterly vision from the painting depicting demonstration of paintings that was painted in 1933. And this painting was actually taken as a blueprint for our action here in a kind of tradition of, let's say, I wouldn't even call it a reenactment because it's rather an enactment of artistic or painterly vision in an actual social practice. And we interpret it as an art on the one-to-one scale, about which Stephen Wright wrote that this is a both a conceptual proposition and a tangible realization of this conceptual potential in social, economic, political practice. And by the way, here is also a side note, maybe interesting for some of you here. Streng formulated his vision of the demonstration of paintings in the context of the artistic policies of the Popular Front Against Fascism and the Congress of Cultural Workers, organized by communist writers and artists self-defining as art workers in 1936 in Lviv, more or less in the same historical moment when Walter Benjamin wrote his Author as Producer, a seminal text, and the artist union self-organized in the context of Work Progress Association. I say it here also to emphasize how these different notions, like art workers, travel between times and spaces, you know, and that they are actually interestingly resurface in lots of different places that not necessarily had a connection, even though I think here this Popular Front Against Fascism served as a platform of communication that also popularized certain notions. But I'm not an art historian, so I'm really not an expert on this. And art on one-to-one scale is both art and more than just art proper, shifts between art worlds and life worlds. It has both meaning and function. Makes use of artistic competences and institutions in social and political praxis. What you see here, it's an image of New World Summit, or like actually Parliament for Rojava, that was built between 2015 and 18 in northern Syria, following the designs by Studio Jonas Stahl. It's also, I think it is also an interesting example how these ideas travel and how the something that was collected, for example, or the, like presented as a model of practice and collected by different artistic institutions in like Van Abbe Museum in Eindhoven in the West became this, the profits made in this way were used in order to build an actual parliament in Rojava. And I think it's an interesting also way how this different idioms kind of travel or are facilitated in the different context, different social contexts. And here also what is important to emphasize, like also in the, especially in the context of feminist critique of wage labor, also feminist critique of authorial labor, is that an artist in such art worlds usually or artist or art worker, interdependent curator, facilitator, animator, initiator, however you name it, it takes on many roles of an initiator, designer, creator, activist, navigator, organizer, cook, mother. The multitude of functions suppressed by the romantic ideals and also exploited in this kind of studio-related, factory-based kind of gallery exhibition nexus with which we are dealing on the top of artistic iceberg. And I think that like when we're writing this, what you see here is a project by River Sisters and Cecilia Malik, a boat trip downstream the Vistula River, organized by them in 2019, is also a kind of art sustaining environment or art activist kind of world organized by female collective. Actually, it's interesting because they call it Sister Rivers and they have also Brother Streams, smaller brothers who support them in the struggle against basically devastation of Polish rivers. It also would require a longer discussion here, but this is kind of like hydro-feminist collective, deeply engaged in campaigning against this devastation of Polish rivers, establishing a lot of alliances with other ecological movements, and also having like one step or like one leg in the kind of artistic mainstream or different artistic institutions. So for example, I think maybe this is also an interesting story. River Sisters were established in result of the individual solo exhibition by Cecilia Malik organized in 2016 in one of the major Polish art galleries in Kraków. And as part of this monographic exhibition, which actually at the end was not really a monographic exhibition, a lot of different experts were invited, and also a lot of co-workers, co-participants or co-initiators who started to work with this devastation or like resist the devastating ecological policies aimed at regulating Polish rivers. And it has thrived since, River Sisters. And then here we also like, that's why like, yeah, I kind of hinted at this when I talked about this like affiliation between the political economy of art, or the critique of the political economy of contemporary art, and the revision of its social ontology. So the question is, of course, one is what art is. So it's like this kind of like art on one to scale, art on one to one scale is kind of trades with that. That it can have like double or triple or multiple different functions and guises, and it depends also on the context in which it is presented, facilitated, and used. It actually addresses one of the central tenets of course of artistic theory, so of the kind of function of art and how questioning how, where, and under which circumstances and by whom can it be used. And I will also here just, I'm heading towards the end of this presentation, I will also not expand on that too much, but I think it is very interesting that this is still considered to be art for art's sake. This is how it is sold, this is how it is explained in the catalogs, this is how it is catalogs of Sotheby's or Christie's, this is how it is revered, and this is how it is evaluated. So we all know this paradox. Basically, art costs so much because it is priceless, and it costs really a lot. But this is considered typically to be art for art's sake, or at least by people who partake in this kind of like a nexus. This is often debunked as a mere activism. So in spite of this kind of it being conceptually charged, of actually in my own humble opinion, being a more interesting artistic practice than most of what is happening as part of Unilever series. And yet it is typically debunked or diminished as a mere activism, like something useful, something which is like dirtied by the social uses of it. And this is a white cube in Lusanga, and this is typically understood as a misuse. So more often than not, this kind of when art is being used or repurposed or like embedded in the social contexts that are not designed with thinking of the affluent or rich and powerful, then this becomes just a functional, instrumentalized, useful art. It's just a community art, right? When this is art proper. So this is also like talking about this visibility and invisibility. I would propose to think about, to have this in mind. Not only that, I would propose to think through this relation between art and its different global uses, this conundrum of both political economy of art and its social ontology, to think about it or analyze it dialectically, following in the footsteps of Rashid Areen. His unbuilt dam in Balochistan is an example of art on what would have been an example of art on one-to-one scale. It was imagined by Areen as a conceptual land art proposition and a functional collective intervention, and it was presented in his text Return to Balochistan from 2001. So in this essay, Areen starts with an aesthetical question. What would be the form of land art most suitable to the deserted landscapes of his home region, Pakistani's region of Balochistan? To which he gives a political answer, a dam and a collective farm. A collective means not only farmed collectively, but actually owned collectively by the collective of workers who would work this land. And in the process, in the process of coming like with this aesthetical question or like formulating aesthetical question, giving this kind of practical political answer, he criticizes both the bourgeois structures of ownership and the homological conventions of authorship that underpin artistic nar egos. And it is a fascinating argument especially because it also, Areen also discusses the dialectics of social sculpture. So he argues that art is a progressive but not sufficient realization of creative ideas. due to the constraints of possessive authorship. So we have like the round anniversary, it's a Boycian year now. Goethe Institute constantly organizes different, and I think rightly so, different activities related to Joseph Beuys. And Arin says, okay, Joseph Beuys' practice was definitely ahead of its time in terms of the development of artistic practice. And social sculpture is definitely a step in right direction. And yet it is a step insufficient. Why? Because of the constraints of authorship, of this limited scarcity that I discussed before. It was always a project by Beuys. He planted only 7,000 oaks, and not only he planted, we know that this actually, this was the work was continued later on. But Arin says, well, Beuys planted only 7,000 oaks and made a great fuss around it. So what he actually argues for is that he finds a full realization of conceptual potential of this idea of Beuys, also of the 7,000 oaks. But this idea was fully realized in distributed creative resistance of people like Wangari Maathai, Nobel Peace Prize winner from 2004, that was given her, to her in recognition of her work on the Green Belt movement that originated in Kenya, I think, in 77, and in result of which millions and millions of trees were planted. And I think that here, of course, it might be considered as some sort of like a slightly debased understanding of activist practice. Obviously, Wangari Maathai and Arin never supposes otherwise, did not realize any kind of Beuysian idea. She made it separately. So it was not that she was inspired by Beuys and then she realized Green Belt, or she organized a Green Belt movement. No, that's why what Arin actually says here is that what matters is not an artistic practice, but rather an idea that inspires it. So he and his book Art Beyond Art, in which this essay is printed, was written in this way. I think this kind of like debasing the authorial, what he says are like artistic and artistic ego, saying that art is like, and rather presenting a, what he calls a kind of like history of the travels of an idea, of this art that is actually, as he says at the end of his Eco Aesthetics Manifesto for the 21st century, art that is being realized, or the potential of which is being realized by this collective struggles of life today, as he calls it. And I like this quote, so maybe I will read it, heading almost to the end of my presentation. And Arin says, the ideas can be and are turned into institutionally manageable objects, thus contained in the temporalities. But ideas as knowledge can never be trapped as the property of an individual or the institution. They can always salvage themselves, give themselves a new context and move forward within the dynamic of new time and space. They can indeed perform a radically new transformative function in dealing with today's situation. But for this, art must go beyond what prevails as art and integrate itself with the collective struggle of life today to recover its true social function and become a radical force of the 21st century. It is in fact artistic imagination, not art object, which once freed from the self-destructive narcissist ego can enter this life and offer it not only salvation, but put it on path to a better future. I also leave it here more as a provocation or more as a food for thought rather than expand on this, because of course we have here like avant-gardistic tropes. I think it's also important to consider that this was written by a person who spent his, by Arin, in his, I think, late 70s after spending 40 years dwelling in the post-colonial theory and practice, establishing third text and many other initiatives that was supposed to actually be direct social interventions as well. But I think also interestingly, maybe at the end, I think this brings forth the question about the function of artistic institutions and indeed the role of interdependent curators. I think we should take into consideration the complexity of artistic ecosystems, the multitudes of agents that inhabit them, the variety of their needs, and the multiplicity of ways in which they make, inhabit, and use art. And I think it is possible to refunction the artistic institution from the agents of gallery exhibition nexus to the new institutions of the common, custodians of shared resources and supporters of art in its manifold guises and functions. And I'm not saying that every art institution could be reorganized in this way. I think there are many artistic institutions, especially the ones that are incorporated on the tip of the artistic iceberg, that are definitely beyond the redemption. The kind of the links with this kind of like art world of 1% are simply too strong to be severed in result of any kind of like of the goodwill of a director or sustained campaigns of art activists, even though I think it is very important to actually try to decolonize these places as it is happening currently in places like New York. Because it requires a sustained effort and a massive political transformation that can be achieved only, I think, as a result of political and social organizing of similar proportions. And the task of interdependent curators might be to contribute to new utopistics, means practically achievable utopias, by partaking in those collective struggles. Definitely, there is a lot to be done, even if it remains unclear what exactly shall we do. And here I will finish. And thank you very much for staying with me for such a, how was it? Like, yeah, almost 1 hour.
Thank you so much. It was really a good and deep dive. And I think we have, or you have, touched upon many themes. I hope we'll have questions regarding to either interdependency or the project area, or for example, decolonization, which you did not forget to mention as one of the most important aspects or theme we have to deal with. I will have one rather generic question to start a conversation with, but I would also ask you not to answer mine, but we'll head over to Greg, because Greg Scholett said that he would like to have a little remark considering the dark matter theory. So my question would be, as you know it well, this FEINART project is basically focusing on 11 early stage researchers. And what would be your first or like most important advice that you would send us on the way to begin this research within this framework of interdependent activism slash practice on the semi-peripheries? But first, I think it's only fair if we head over to Greg Scholett, so that
maybe Greg can I can easily, I mean, let's, if you ask the question, let me answer, because I think my answer will be pretty short. My response or advice would be enjoy it as long as it lasts, you know. I mean the FEINART project. Because obviously when it comes to financing this kind of research, it is a pretty unique opportunity. And I think the question to FEINART as such would be how to realize its ambition of supporting this kind of like more distributed networks, or like main self-organized, or with fragile, ephemeral art worlds, or actually convince artistic institutions to be institutions of the commons rather than agents of gallery exhibition nexus. And this is something that definitely does not require my answer, but rather our collective reflection. And because it's not an easy thing to do, I mean, especially as a researcher. I think that quite a few of people here are embedded in different art-related initiatives. I typically, when I ask myself about the role of artistic theory, that in fact most of us, or like most of the fine art, ES, like how it is called, the awful name ESR, but most of the researchers, or like Young also is a weird name because of let's say doctoral researchers in the program, also ask themselves like the role of the theory in this kind of situations. I would say, following with this feminist deconstruction of capitalocentric economy, it is ultra important to deconstruct and to not deconstruct, but also practically shift the notions of artistic theory and embed it also in the social practices. So I would possibly say that sometimes like action research is a very good approach because it helps you to understand the practical nuances of the fields in which you function. And it, you know, like when you once you are part of the situation in which somebody tells you, oh, well, you know, like as a curator, oh, well, this does not really deserve to be exhibited here. Sorry, I was just taking a look at what Angela wrote. Like when somebody tells you, oh, it should not be supported because it is not real art proper, then you really start to think, well, you know, maybe we should actually think about how these definitions of art are being made. And I can tell you that this type of things do have political purchase, or like also they do influence how, for example, different types of public programs are being organized. Currently, we are working with the Citizens Forum, or like artistic trade unions in Poland, on the system of retirement. Like basically, in Polish system, artists do not have any right to retirement because they typically do not work on as wage laborers, and retirement systems are directly embedded in kind of pension systems that are the pension systems are embedded in the structures of wage labor. So artists are typically excluded from this kind of pension systems. And then it's a question, right? Like it's a practical question of who should be part of this kind of system when it is devised for artists. And the authoritarian conservative answer is only people who are real artists. And real artist is like this guy who, like people think about real artists as this guy who paint horses, right? This is a real artist, and this person deserves to have a pension. While a person who, for example, makes digital art, or who is like who partakes in River Sisters, who cooks, who organizes, who navigates, who makes art, and so on and so forth, does not, because did not finish an art school or does not make paintings proper. So, you know, and then you have questions about, for example, and I was part of the political negotiations of this kind of systems, right? So, for example, you have the questions about how to define artist, who is an artist, who is not an artist. And then, and for example, the response was, and possibly this will be implemented, that only artistic unions will be able to define who an artist is or not. The problem is that most of these unions are actually directly embedded in the authoritarian cultural policies. So with the direct stakes in actually maintaining this kind of strict boundaries between fields. It is strictly differently organized in Germany with Kunstler, Sozialkasse, and so on, but I'm just telling you where it is more approached to kind of like different creatives. But then typically this kind of discussions do have a direct or indirect influence of how policies are being framed. So that would be a long-winded response to your question, from enjoy it as long as it lasts to the political function of different commonsensical and theoretical aspects of what art is and what is not.
Thank you. I think we will try to enjoy it as long as it lasts. And sorry for Greg Scholet that I stole some time. Now it's time for your question or remark.
Thank you, Gabor. Thank you, Kuba. Yeah, I maybe I can keep it in the same vein and just swing it around a bit. I just wanted to sort of put, you know, I know you know this well, Kuba. The book, the sort of concept of dark matter was really about the moment that this so-called dark matter or non-reflective labor, this kind of surplus archive of many, many, you know, attempts to create the kind of projects you were showing, failures, ambitions, et cetera. It was really about the moment that that stopped being dark, right? That was the whole point of the book was, you know, this thing that we couldn't see that's holding up the structure is now stepping into visibility, and it's irrepressible. It's not gonna like just go back into so the shadows. So that's important, I think, to remember in terms of the trajectory of the thesis for what it's worth, right? Within that sort of dark matter realm, and I think John Roberts has done a wonderful job too at articulating aspects of this. There are these kind of like counter institutions or para or even artificial institutions. I call them mock institutions because they sometimes even mimic official institutions that have been sort of, you know, gutted, particularly in places like the US, you know, after the rise of, you know, liberalism. But I have a feeling it's not so different in Poland today and other places. So artists create these kind of like spaces of institutional seeming authority. When you actually look under the hood of the car, you find it's just a couple of people with a laptop, right? But it looks from the outside like some sort of, you know, school of this, or, you know, the league of like blah, 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 right? The carbon free zone. And it's kind of a really interesting, I think, phenomena, especially when you consider that so much of this phase of the 1990s, artists were trying to do kind of what Hirt Loving and David Garcia suggested, which was to not hold ground, right? To simply be interventionists and to always kind of pull out and never sort of assert any kind of like space, right? So you have kind of fake space, but you don't have like actual space like you would have had previously with say the sort of new left or counterculture or whatever. Okay, I think we've swung quite a ways around. This dark matter is so bright. Nobody anymore believes that the art world is, you know, this kind of like institutional facade. Nobody believes it's institutional facade. Liberate Tate is an example, Gulf Labor. I mean, who's kidding who? You know, the art world presents itself as part of the 1%. It does it sometimes assertively, authoritatively, you know, with pleasure. And so I think we live in a bear art world. Again, I'm using a term from Agamben, you know, we're basically in a very bright zone where there is no shadows per se. And so I think that's kind of where we've sort of swung full around. And as you say, I think this question of institutions that I want to try to link to Angela's comment and then get out of the way is very, very important. The New York City just rolled out like 3 days ago this enormous, relatively enormous sort of like a sort of financially supported cultural program, which sort of harkens back to the days of FDR in the 1930s, like the Workers Project Association, the various federal art programs. It's as if we're sort of suddenly rediscovering everything that we tried to toss out starting back in like the late 70s and early 80s with Ronald Reagan and so forth. So I think it's an interesting moment, even in the US, which is like at the cutting edge, you might say, has been of sort of neoliberalism in some ways. And I would just say one last thing, look at what's happening inside the museums across the United States. It's really fascinating to me. You have a younger, mostly younger generation of people who mostly studied art, either, you know, fine art, MFA, maybe BFA, or maybe art history, or maybe cultural studies. And they studied Andrea Fraser, they studied Hans Anken, they studied institutional critique, and they're all trying to unionize now. So it's almost as if another wave of institutional critique is happening, not as bona fide art works, but directly within the mechanism of the institution itself. The dark matter, you might say, is self-organizing and, you know, transforming the institution from the inside. You're absolutely right. You know, the doubts that we all have, like, okay, that's great, but will it take us where we need to go? The question of decoloniality is a much bigger question. And I'm exactly like you are, you know, artists should have the right to good pay, they should have pensions. They have, on the other hand, it doesn't really solve the problems that we're raising theoretically or politically. I agree with you there, absolutely. Okay, that's all I really wanted to say. And thanks for a great presentation, by the way.
Yeah, thanks, Greg. Thanks so much. I mean, I was like, Thank you for the comment. I'm not sure whether it requires any additional musings from my side.
I think, can I say something in response to that? I think Kuba, you're underestimating the huge transformation that is taking place or has taken place that Greg was addressing there. I think there is now a kind of ontological break between those practitioners who believe the making of objects for exchange on the market constitutes an artistic act and those that don't. And it seems now that the only way to make art as a living condition is through the rejection of the production of objects for exchange on the market. Because to produce objects for exchange on the market, irrespective of the radical content of those objects or not, involves you in the production of dead or deadening social relations. And socially engaged art, in a sense, is the emergent category for the recognition of that reality.
Well, yeah, that was one of my arguments, I would say. So
were you talking as if you were addressing a bunch of collectors or people who weren't particularly aware of what's at stake? And I enjoyed your presentation, your intervention. But there was a sense in which that we needed to do certain things in order to change things. When things are changing as a consequence of the actual artistic implosion of the art market. $9 million, but artistically it is imploding.
Well, you know, like if we think about I mean, this is, of course, it's like about like preaching to the choir, and not only to the choir but ultra educated choir of experts in the field that I cover. Yes, I mean, like, you know, it's on the other hand, I'm not sure whether this can be assumed that this is a shared knowledge. And I think that this is also something that is being debated. Even as I understood our discussions with Greg about the bear art world, and whether this is really considered to be, and this art world of 1% or whatever, it's actually much tinier. I think it still has, I'm here a bit of a kind of like devil's advocate, but it still has called an enormous hegemonic influence. You know, like I think that if you think about, for example, like different forms of artistic institutions, I think the ones who are in fact closely aligned with the socially engaged art is rather a minority. I wish it was different, but it's not. I mean, this is still, it obviously is typically, it's something else. It's like, it's not necessarily, you know, like selling or buying art for $1 million bucks. They do not have, like, I mean, like the entire budget for collections in Poland is about 700, how much? About like $800,000, like distributed by the Ministry of Culture to different museums, right? So of course these institutions do not have even a purchase power to become part of the playground to which they do aspire. So like this kind of tip of the iceberg do have a pretty hegemonic appeal. Like when we did back in 2016, I curated the exhibition in which we tried to cover this kind of socially engaged. And I think also that quite of these things are not necessarily socially engaged, but another thing, I think Angela was pointing at that, or like politically engaged even farther from it. Some of them are actually pretty not politically engaged, but in this practice in the expanded field, I mean. But anyway, we curated a survey in the Museum of Modern Art with Sebastian Cichocki called Making Use. And at the same time, there was an exhibition organized by the same museum called Bread and Roses, which basically repeated all the Andrea Fraser's argument as if they were valid for all art ever and universally applicable. When we talk, for example, in activist circles or like art activist circles about how to cooperate with the artistic institutions, very often come up different or emerge different forms of argument or accusations that are related to what art is, that kind of assume that all art is basically something which is in fact a purchasable, collectible, sellable object of that is exhibitable in artistic institutions. You know, so I wish that it was different, but unfortunately it isn't. So that's why I let myself to understand these arguments that I know that you all, or the person like you, definitely knows very well. Sorry for that.
Of course, the ideology of the market and the ideology of the 1% is hegemonic. And of course, people assume in a commonplace fashion that the making of art is the making of objects for exchange. But the making of art as a sphere of activity that's engaged in important questions around emancipation, the commons, as you've talked about, cannot be secured simply through the production of discrete objects for sale on the market. And because of that, the market is now a place where art and emancipation and critique and the commons is a dead zone. So if you want to continue to make art and think about art in a reflexive manner, if you want to continue to make art and see it linked in some crucial sense with the transformation of social experience and social relations and the critical legacy of philosophy, the only place to do that kind of thinking is in the domain of post-art art, as you call it, and others do. There's no, currently, historically, there's no other possibility.
Yeah, don't,
so, you know, so like, we may be the walking dead at one level, but there's no other domain where these kinds of practices and reflections will be done.
Sorry, now I have to interrupt you guys. It's a really fruitful conversation, but there is already three other questions. One is in the chat from Angela Dimitrika, which I'm sorry we didn't address before. So Angela is asking Kuba if he could attempt to think the difference between institutions of common and independent art institutions, because there are notable differences also between the common and public space. So first of all, could you please, Kuba, reflect on that? And then, if I'm not mistaken, it's Karen and then Sophie.
Okay, cool. So maybe I'll just, I think so as well. I mean, there is a significant difference. I'm talking about these different institutional models. You need to consider those differences, and possibly they are in the making in this way that if you think, for example, about how the independent, like how how structured, what are the structures, both conceptual edifices and basically also institutional public state, like statues and how the buildings are being constructed. Most of the artistic institutions require a transformation in order to become institutions of the common, however we would consider them. Because, for example, currently, one of the main premises of the most of the public institutions are collections. Collections typically understood as collecting even individual artworks. I'm also talking about public art institutions. Interestingly, like, you know, what is the function of these public art institutions in relation to the art market? That's another question. Sometimes, like, it is like it's actually pretty well also analyzed in when we consider this kind of like mega institutions and the function of creating artistic value, what is the role of collectors on the boards, how the collections map the private collections are closely integrated with public collections, how the exhibition practices are related to, for example, like mega galleries and who is actually getting exhibited. I think most of the, like, this is like, especially in some of the, let's say, major art institutions, these circuits are closely integrated. And I think our peripheric situations, most of the public collections of this kind of like semi-autonomous institutions, when they are being considered in this kind of like let's say in the traditional manner, of the institutions embedded in the bourgeois public sphere, they still consider themselves as national treasuries, you know. So this notion resurfaces very often. For example, in the discussions about what can be collected, what cannot be collected, people typically in art institutions in Poland, they have it's much more problematic for them to collect the things that are being produced collectively, because the attribution is unclear. And why I'm talking about collection, not because I like collections. I think that these are like, I more share this kind of avant-gardistic notions of institutions as cemeteries, you know, of life processes. But then still it is important because it's one of the few ways, and maybe this is a FEINART task to change it, one of the few ways how money are being distributed to artists by purchasing objects. If you compare like with streams of financial support that are at least are in disposal of different artistic institutions, you compare, for example, like possibly collections to honoraries are like 1 to 10 or something like that, right? And often, like that was also one of the discussions that we had with artistic trade unions. The practice that had to be changed is to start paying honoraries for partaking in exhibitions, not to change artists into wage laborers, as some people would argue, but rather in order to provide alternative income streams so that these people can later on also partake in these different art worlds that are, of course, and then these art worlds, this is also important to be said, they're also quite often shoestring subsistence type of economies. And I think that this is important not to idealize them while also not patronize them. So in a sense, you know, at least from what I, how I see, it's often people just do shift between different transactional domains. In a sense that, like, they, for example, make their studio artists, and then they also partake in the art worlds. You know, like they have an interestingly, and maybe this is a very important shift that has to be taken into account. This studio practice is becoming considered to be a job, you know, not an epitome of autonomy, but rather a job, the thing that you have to do in order to make your living, which is a huge reversal of fortunes and of ideas, maybe more contributing to what John said. And of course, it's not about independence, like very often, coming back to Angela's question, independence recent years before this wave of occupations and or in parallel, because it's also very, these are like dynamic social processes. Independence in Poland, for example, in let's say mid 2000s and 2010s, was considered as establishing a private gallery. Right, having a roster of artists, and then you are becoming an independent artist when you have a gallery representation. Or if you imagined an artist-run space, often it mimicked this kind of like economies. There were a few examples of things organized otherwise, and I think that they rather became more prominent. Why I think there are like quite a lot of explanations why it happens. One of them, like also like Greg also explained on the American example, which is I think quite quite interesting. But a lot of people do understand the economies of this aspirational or like the mistakes of this aspirational rat race that motivated previously or like also underpinned the hegemonic power of this the tip of the artistic iceberg. So yes, institutions of the commons, it needs to rephrase and rethink themselves. For example, in what would be the questions leading this process? For example, where does institution finish? And what matters for it? Does it matter what artworks are being presented, or it matters how people are working for it? Then artworks, does it like, is it kind of like, if you think about collections, is it a public resource and what would that entail? Is it distributed widely, or is it kind of considered as be part of the as be part of its own treasury house and then kept in the inside of the walls? Like Van Abbe Museum made a lot of these experiments with sending Picasso to Ramallah or different things to different places, like the White Cube in Lusanga, right? So it's also the question of this art treasuries. Then it's a question also, what kind of responsibilities does such art institution of the common would have? Would it be responsible also for the well-being of the art workers with which it operates? And who? How large is this artistic ecosystem? What kind of relations does it have, such institution of the common, with other agents in the local artistic ecosystem? Does it compete with them for attention, publics, or was it typically overproducing on different public programs, exhibitions, and so on? Or rather, would it have a more sustainable type of approach? For example, paying for development of artistic practices, but considering the amount of people who are part of the artistic ecosystem and how it is structured, it is a very hard task to do in the framework of the also not only cultural but also social policies that we are here considering. So like in the place of in Greece telling that artist-run space or like a curatorial initiative should support the art workers, it's impossible if you do not have any type of public grants available, right? This would be an idealistic kind of overstatement, but then it can still establish a kind of creative and more sustainable and equalitarian type of relations with other agents and people who work for it and other institutions or PATA institutions or mock institutions that surround it. That would be my response, also quite long-winded.
Angela, if you don't have a comment for Kuba as like a direct response and you felt that it was a good address of your question, then we have to...
I do have a
question. You do? Okay. So can I please just ask, it's not a personal thing. It's just like we're running a little short on time. We have 22 minutes left. So please, everyone.
I think the distinction private, public, common should be upheld here in the way that we get it. We inherit it from political theory. And this terminology, institutions of the common, does come from Hart and Negri. They described in detail. And I'm saying this also in relation to projects that we have, which perhaps focus on the public sphere, because very often it is very hard to define what is public, which is normally state-funded, right? And this can have collections, Kuba. But in fact, institutions of the common do start from below. And you have presented as such an institution. I remember in Athens, you went to Green Park. You were invited to Green Park, which was an institution of the common. It was not initiated by the state. It doesn't have a tax number. A previous speaker, Ileana Fokianaki, had made this distinction here, you know, during her talk. And so the way these institutions function, which come together actually quite autonomously, they do need to work either with private or with state-funded institutions because they have no money. So the distinction is relatively easy to make. And I think it bears very much on how, on where socially engaged art is done and how, because a lot of it is done actually in institutions of the common. They do exist, but they're very hard to maintain and they don't have collections because no one trusts, you know, their work to an institution that doesn't have the right premises, if I can put it this way. So that's my brief comment.
I know. Yeah, I think, like, yeah, of course, it's a very good intervention, because I focused on the public institutions that can become commonized, so to say. So, like, I would say, I focused in most of my here response to you on this kind of institutions rather than emergent self-organized collectives. Maybe I'm too embedded within them to even. One not see the woods for the trees kind of thing. Yes, sure. Of course, you are completely right. And I would concur. You have the vast realm of emergent kind of a smog, pata, para, nomadic, monster institutions. Most of the arts, or like this plausible art worlds that I quoted, is precisely mapping of this kind of institutions. And potentially, a lot of the these notions of the commons, yes, are much more prevalent there, even though, as we all know, the secondary economy of art is riven with its own problems, which is basically subsistence economies. They are, like, as you said, I mean, this is like underfunded, underfinanced, or it's self-financed, which means that people need to work somewhere else in order to finance this kind of thing. But, like, as Gabo said at the beginning of my talk, I'm currently working on the Office for Post Artistic Services, which possibly could be interpreted in this kind of institution of the common, more of an emergent kind of bottom-up type of self-organization. But I also think that there are processes of kind of becoming common, or turning the public, or trying to turn public institutions into more of a common resource. Which I think are pretty interesting, like, you know, this, for example, constituent museums, or like useful museums. It's very hard to say how it is actually, and I think stakes are here also quite high, because it's very important to consider how this public type of finance, or common finances, or however, you know, would be, could be used or
reported. Absolutely. I was just trying to bring this three-part distinction into focus, for the benefits of the researchers primarily. Thank you.
Sure. Of course, you are right.
Yep. Thank you for both. Yes, I think this is now Karen's turn, and I don't see Sophie's head raised hand anymore. Is it because she wanted to lower it, or she just forgot? You have a couple of minutes to think about. It's Karen's question now.
Yeah, I'm coming back to the very start of your talk, and I want to ask the question again, what are we getting ourselves into when we talk about, or when we use this metaphor of the tip of the iceberg and the distinction between the visible part and the invisible part underneath the surface. And I also want to come back to Greg's metaphor of dark matter, because what I really like about it is that in a way it's more dialectical and it's more complex, because his argument is at least that the dark matter is a kind of drive system of what you call the peak of the iceberg. This is what I really like about it, that this dark matter is the energy that actually makes the visible part of it visible. And when I look at your metaphor of the tip of the iceberg and all this invisible practices underneath the surface, I ask myself, what would be the consequence then if we think of how we want to change it? And is the consequence then, and I assume that you don't like it, the economization of everything, so that all the other parts become visible and become paid labor as well? And I think this is a kind of danger of this metaphor. And I'm really interested in how you respond on that.
Yeah, well, this is a thank you for this question. Yes, the iceberg as a as an image suggests some kind of like stable system, which is one of its main drawbacks. I don't think that this is an intention, and that's not how it was created by feminist economists, and neither it is my intention when I use it. I think it is actually, it is used in order to underpin exactly what you said, which is a dynamic relationship between what they call either a kind of tip of economic iceberg and what happens beneath it. So this was used in order to emphasize that capitalism as such is, it is not possible, it cannot run without the continuous exploitation of its own, either, like I wouldn't call it other, but without the exploitation of kind of invisible labor of women, but also of the externalities basically of economic equation. And the externalities are created and maintained socially precisely in order to facilitate this this exploitation. So yes, it is a metaphor, and as every metaphor, it has its limits, but the concept is more to emphasize that economy is much larger than what is being visible, and visibility is also a potentially misleading term, because then we might think, oh, like, you know, it is actually in, also this is actually invisible. But of course, like the labor of the labor of women is enough to go to the kindergarten. It's enough to go to the streets. It's enough to see any kind of space that is being cleaned in order to see it. It's actually prevalent. It is seen everywhere, but it is invisible in economic terms. So this is where, so also I tried to emphasize it, but maybe I was not clear. It's so it is economically invisible means it is unpaid, or is considered not as an economy proper. The same thing happens with, and then of course, what typically happens is also, that can happen, or it's one of these crude jokes that is, if you want to rise the GDP, you should employ a person who cares for your kids as a paid employee, right? So this would be the way how to make it in the economically visible, but in a very neoliberal terms. I think that what is here at stake is, in fact, and this, like, what the second part of your question hugs back to the discussions about wages for housework. And I think this was very often misunderstood precisely in a way how it is presented. It was actually debunked as a way of thinking, and it is actually very often a raised argument till these days, I think, but it was often debunked as a demand for capitalizing every part of human existence, and it wasn't, definitely. If you think about how Silvia Federici thinks about commons, is in fact preserving the pockets that are resistant to accumulation. They are resistant to accumulation because they do not partake in the economic calculi that is organized in accordance with the rules of capitalism. It does not mean that they do not require support. In contrast, they do require support, but this support can be organized in a lot of different ways. For example, by squatting a park, right? Or by squatting a green park, or by squatting, like Angela was saying, or by collectivizing care. Right? Or by demanding that the state, for example, or like the different forms of redistribution, if you are on the more social democratic side, are employed in order to redirect flows of resources to sustain this kind of things. So this might mean, for example, a kindergarten. That might mean a support for the collective kindergarten. And I think that precisely this discussion about wages for housework is a very good example of how we can consider the more recent debates on the wages for artwork, but also on the ways of supporting artwork commons or basically artistic commons. But this is not about making all what we kind of think about here, like this socially engaged art, to be peddled and to be turned into objects that are being marketable. I think that this would be a vast mistake, or exhibitable if we think that exhibiting means turning objects into potentially collectible and potentially sellable art. I rather think that we can consider about different means and modes of support that would not require artists to become or to aspire to become like art stars, most of them ever want, but rather to devise different forms of support systems, some of them self-organized, but also of and most of them even self-organized. If you ask me, I would prefer everything to be self-organized. But then also to think about the stable systems of welfare commons-based support that would enable people to pursue art in whatever ways they want, or like art or kind of whatever they want to call art, in the social circumstances under their own condition. Under their own choosing of their own making. But this would be an idealistic, a bit idealistic or utopistic picture, especially, of course, if we think about the global scale. That's why I think, like, for example, one of the most interesting things, maybe we're finishing this stuff, or demand is like formulated by Institution for Radical Imagination, this manifesto Art for UBI, Art for Universal Basic Income, or different modes of support that are not means tested and that are universally applicable. Because this is also another thing, and I also showed Ukiele's slide on purpose, because I think that the only social support systems that would function properly are the ones that are actually universally applicable and would support all workers or all care workers equally. And that's where lies political potential of the socially engaged art at its best, kind of most sort of reflective and politically conscious level.
Okay, so we have two questions left. One is from Sophie and the other one is from Alexei. And also we have 9 minutes left. I don't really know what will happen exactly at 7:30 BST time, but yeah, if it just cuts, let me say thank you, Kuba, especially for delivering the talk. Thank you for all the participation. Thank you for all the engagement, the questions and the comments. People who are in the FEINART project, you guys know the secret link. We can carry on the conversation for longer, but the official Zoom event will end at 7:30 for sure. But so now this is Sophie's question.
Hi, Kuba. Thanks for your talk. I'm very drawn to actually something that I feel maybe we've lost sight of because we've got stuck in concepts or big concepts. Your comment about the semi-periphery in the art world and the way in which theory is kind of imposed or imported to frame aspirations onto local agents. And I was thinking then, what is the role of export, or what maybe would projects such as your Free Slow University, like how do they then interact with the dynamic of needing to export or make visible or prove value, but also maybe to avoid or resist the kind of visibility of the global. So something, a kind of question, a half question around knowledge production, but also curious how you would frame your own project within the kind of talk that you've just given.
Yeah, it's an excellent question. I just wonder how to how to get there, considering seven minutes. You know, maybe I'll just give you an example. You know, like when we started the Consortium for Post-Artistic Practices, its main thrust is a kind of anti-fascist organizing, and it happened in 2015 and 16. And we started to joke that finally we are in the vanguard of the political transformation. Because what is happening in countries like Poland or Hungary spells it's a writing on the wall for countries like Holland or France or wherever else. So it is just like, you know, and yet it's just partially a joke, you know, because I think that this is that there is a lot of things happening that are much more distributed than they used to be. And possibly that's why I also, when I talked about this tip of artistic iceberg and that what is happening in New York or London or wherever else, that it is much larger than what is happening on the top of it. I think it is actually the case, you know, that there is a lot of theory work and artwork and practices that are very similarly organized from the bottom up in the different parts of the world. Like that's why there is a flow of inspiration that I don't think is of this kind of, let's say, that could be understood in as an import or export from the West to East or East to West or something like that, you know, or North to South, etc. I think it's much more complex than that, you know. But then, and also because lots of these people, our comrades or friends do struggle with quite similar problems like we are facing, which is, for example, this hegemonic structure that hovers above this kind of plethora of the different emergent art worlds. You know, like, so for example, people do need to consider what to do when their friends are also collectible artists. You know, like, and this happens in Warsaw, this happens also in Amsterdam, you know, like, are the traitors of our collective cause, or maybe contributors to the things that we do, because they bring different things to the fold. You know, is of Biennale a just an outlet of the local elites, or a who were stripped of the functions in artistic institutions adapted? It's also an emergent structure that works in this Lumbung type of relations with other collectives abroad. You know, and I think also that quite a few of these things, like for example, not getting fixated on the, or like thinking that art can be of many different uses, and sometimes an object, sometimes it's sellable, sometimes you just bring it and repurpose it, and you have like this kind of like more hybrid situations in which a lot of different people partake. That might be also a bit semi-peripheric, you know, that these divisions are less formalized, because also the stakes are less, are smaller. You know, and people do shift. For example, like one of my best friends who is an organizer of the artistic trade union, she also sells art, and I don't think that she's working on a desert of the real, you know. I think that she's actually pretty keen on the on artwork advocacy. And you know, and this kind of things, because also it's more accidental, you know, it's not this kind of art starry type of thing which pulls you to the very particular kind of type of circulation. And hope that it responds to, at least partially, to your question. But and I hope to discuss it much more when you come to Warsaw, because I think it's a fascinating stuff. And it's also an interesting, you know, it's an interesting phenomenon which was very how to say it, that was forgotten in this kind of like neoliberalization of the public spheres globally after 89, which means like the movements of non-aligned countries or the different kind of like different type of relations between like South-South, East-South, South-East, you know, like different forms, different formations that were obviously decimated by the rise of neoliberalism in 80s. And I guess that politically is also one of the most important repurposing. Yes, but this would be also a legacy to be taught about on a political level. Hope it responds at least partially.
So the thing is now that it's 7:28, and my question is whether we should be considerate for our colleagues at the University of Wolverhampton who are nice enough to provide us technical support, and they also have to go home soon, or, and we continue this conversation, because there was two questions, both of which could be continued, obviously for a long time, but then I would also try to use just 1 minute to announce again that the next part of the next episode of the FEINART lecture series will be by Maria Klavajova from Bach on the 3rd of June, as well as there is another event, which is British Art Show 9 and Socially Engaged Art, which is going to be on the 21st of May, so next Friday. Please join. All of the details will be visible on the FEINART either Facebook page or the website. And I think I'm sorry, Alexei. I think it's not going to be enough time for the question today. But thank you so much again, Kuba Szreder, for the University of Warsaw and the Biennale Warszawa to be with us and deliver the lecture.
Exactly. We should also thank Biennale Warszawa, who is an institution supporting our support structure here. Thank you, Biennale Warszawa, for helping to co-organize this. And thank you, all of you. And I'm sorry to miss Alexei's questions. And I think that the last question of Greg on repurposing, refunctioning of social apparatuses is one of the crucial one thing here. I guess this is like the crucial thing, in fact. And what Sophie said about cross-fertilizations, I think it's also a ultra important aspect of what can be discussed. And hopefully one of the things that FEINART as such can also serve as, this kind of like platform for cross-fertilization between different contexts. So maybe coming back to your initial question of Gabo. So yes, thank you. Thank you very much to everyone, and looking forward to see you in a sec.
Thank you.